I was one of the first generations of young people who wanted to become an actor because they saw an actor on the screen. Before me, people used to become an actor because they went to the theatre. And they thought, that's what I'd like to do. So it was very much a middle class kind of, or upper class kind of thing in very class conscious England, until this happened. And then working class children had never seen acting except at school, in the school play, which is where I started when I was 10. And so the first real acting I saw, a professional actor, was on screen.
Was I right or was I? You and your Sunday school talk about protecting people's goods. You. Come on, stand up and take it like a man. Come on, get up!
And I became absolutely enamored with the cinema. I'm one of the greatest film buffs. I'm a film goer. I see every film, no matter what the quality, I see every film. I adore the cinema. And I became a stage actor in order to learn what to do. But my final destination was always to be a movie actor. And once I got a part in a movie, I never went back to the theater, because that was what was in my mind. The stage was a learning process for me, because I never went to drama school. I came from a milieu which never knew what a drama school was, let alone go there. Someone told me, you can go to drama school and learn acting. I would have called them an idiot.
Are you coming in, or are you going to piss about all day?
You're bloody finished, you know that, Jack? I'll bloody finish you!
Not till I'm dead, Eric.
Working class actors came along, like me, Albert Finney, Peter O'Toole, these guys in England. We came along in the 60s, just at the same time as the writers. John Osborne, Arnold Wesker, who started writing about working class people. But the strangest thing was that the first movie they're showing here at the Cinematheque of my retrospective is Zulu, where I was cast completely against type as a very upper crust officer. And I am the exact opposite of that. I'm what's called a Cockney.
I'm the villain in the family, remember?
I don't think an English director would have cast me in that character. But the director was Cy Enfield, who was an American. And he said, I went up to play the Cockney working class corporal in the movie. And I was just leaving the bar at the Prince of Wales Theatre. Actually, in fact, my whole success of movie success is depended on the length of the bar at the Prince of Wales Theatre. Because if it had been 5 yards shorter, I'd have been out of the door and he'd have said, oh, to hell with it. But he stopped me at the door and he said, can you do an upper crust accent, Cy Enfield? And I said, yeah, I've been in rep for 10 years. I could do any accent. And he said, because you don't look like a Cockney to me. I don't know what he thought. I think a Cockney should look like some kind of gangster. That's what we are.
Remember, they're killers, just like you.
But I didn't look like that. I was a very tall, slender guy with long blonde hair. You know, I mean, I was very tough inside, but I looked a little bit gay on the outside. Because you know, and I was... and I was very slim. I just had malaria, so I was very, very slim. And he said, I think you'd make a good officer. And he cast me as the Lieutenant Bromhead in Zulu. I went up for a Cockney part Oliver Twist to play the Cockney, what's his name? Anyway, Cockney, Bill Sykes. And I went up to audition for that, and I didn't get it. And I thought, well, I am that. You know, I'm a very tough Cockney guy, and I can't even get that. And I was completely shattered. And about 3 years later, I was driving by the theatre in my own Rolls Royce, with quite a lot of money in the bank. And I looked up and I saw the name of the guy who got the part. And I started to tremble because I thought, my God, I could have got that and I would be there, you know? So you never know when something bad is really good for you. Because that was a moment of despair for me. I couldn't get a tough Cockney guy.
Where's Albert? Where's Albert?
I know where to find him.
Insanity is what keeps everybody who thinks they can do something going against all odds. I mean, I was told to give it up by so many times. My friends would tell me as a favour, not enemies, my friends would tell me, you know, to stop knocking yourself out. You're never going to get anywhere. My own agent told me, but she said, I'll keep going. Then she dropped dead. She dropped dead, and then I got a new agent, which was very fortunate.
What are you going for?
To find out what happened.
I remember a journalist once said to me, what do you think of the 60s, you know? Now, living through the 60s, like we are now, you know, like in 1971. And I remember saying, I think when I'm older, people will be asking me about the 60s. I said, because it sort of happened. Before that, there was the war and then post-war. And I always regarded it as before the 60s, everything was in black and white. After the 60s, it was in Technicolor. Because the 60s sort of coloured up. We lived very drab lives. Remember, in the 50s, we were still on rationing for a lot of things. A lot of stuff was still on rationing. So life had been very drab. And also there was the class system, which we decided to dump. And we did.
Yes, you can.
Oh, God, Jack Gordon!
Who sent you?
Ruby!
There we are, you see? Now you could tell me.
It was quite extraordinary because everyone you knew became sort of famous in the 60s. I shared a flat with John Barry, who wrote all the great music, the Bond music. I shared a flat with my barber, who was Vidal Sassoon. I shared a flat with Terence Stamp. I opened a restaurant and I got this painter to do the logo on the restaurant, and that was David Hockney. I remember there was an actor I knew, and he was down on his luck, and he was even in a worse state than me. And he said, I'm giving it up, I'm going to write instead. So we all laughed, and that was John Osborne, and he wrote Look Back in Anger.
What's that, 100?
That's right, Harry.
I worked with an actor called David Barron, and then he said it was too tough, he was going to give it up. He said, and I'm going to write plays under my own name. I said, well, isn't David Barron your real name? He said, no. I said, what's your real name, David? He said, Harold Pinter. So, you know, even the successful were successful. It was quite an extraordinary era. I even remember, like, Terence Stamp had a brother who, you know, he wasn't talented in any of that. He was very intelligent, very bright, but he wasn't skilled. He was working class, exactly like myself. And he came back from the pub one night. He said, I'm going to be a rock and roll manager. So we all said, oh, really? Yeah, yeah. He said, yeah. I said, you'll need a group. He said, I've got a group from the pub. I said, what's it called? He said, The Who. So there was no way you could go wrong then. You know, I sort of feel sorry for people starting out now because it's so tough. But everything we touched seemed to turn to gold then.
So, you're doing all right then, Eric. You're making good.
Making a living.
Good prospects for advancement, is there? Huh? A pension? Do you know, I had almost forgotten what your eyes look like.
They're still the same. Piss holes in the snow.
Still got a sense of humour.
Charles Laughton came through in a play. And we all said, I was up there with Robert Shaw. And we said, let's go and see. It was a different matinee from ours. We were in a play. Said, let's go and see the play. And Charles Laughton, you know, was great, one of the greatest actors for actors, in, you know, for anybody. But and it was Charles Laughton in person in a play. And we went and saw him in this play, and there was this young guy came on, and he sort of outdid him, you know. And he was only about 25, 26. And we all thought, Jesus Christ, who's this? And we went back to see him because one of the guys knew him. It was Albert Finney. And it happened over and over again.
Don't you think we ought to talk about him?
Get Carter was a film that I produced, actually, with Michael Klinger, who already owned the rights. And that was a gangster film made to show that violence from gangsters is swift, sudden, and without warning. I come from real gangsters, and they don't go, oh, if you do that, I'm going to hit you. And there's no word. It just goes bang, and you're dead, you're gone, you're cut, you're whatever. They don't tell you anything or smash you to smithereens with sadistic. They do one thing.
Jack. Ooh. You shouldn't have shown the film to Frank.
I had to. It was the only way I could get at them.
Well, you shouldn't have. Your brother was going to the police.
You should.
He had seen so many films where there were fights and you get smashed here and smashed there, and you come to work the next day with a piece of plaster on here. We wanted to show that one punch there and four teeth are out, your lips are swollen for 6 weeks, you've probably broken your nose, you know? One punch.
Can I?
And then we got reviews like it was the most violent movie of all time. And I said, how many people did we kill in here? They said, well, half a dozen, a dozen. I said, two. We wanted to show what real violence was like and what real criminals are like. They are quite icy about everything, and they make up their mind. They don't tell you it's coming. It just comes. Then they tell you it's been.
When we're in South America, we'll make love in the sun. Roll over. Make love again. And again.
We did this whole scene with the phone sex. Before there was phone sex, I was wondering if someone was watching it and said, hey, here's a great idea, because I'm looking for my percentage. I never got one. Something like phone sex wouldn't interest me at all. I can't understand it, and I know that they make millions out of it, and I did it in Get Carter. But, I mean, it wouldn't mean a thing to me. I don't even answer the phone, and I don't make phone calls, let alone phone about sex.
Hello? Oh, I miss you.
I fancy you.
You never work with a director. He decides he wants to work with you. You know, you don't say, I'm going to be directed by Steven Spielberg. Steven Spielberg says, you're going to be directed by Steven Spielberg. I've been very lucky with directors, right through Joe Mankiewicz, John Huston, Joe Losey. I've been pretty lucky. I finally wound up being directed by John Huston, playing Humphrey Bogart's character in The Man Who Would Be King, which, funnily enough, was when I was in Paris when I got the phone call from John Huston saying, would you like to do The Man Who Would Be King? And I was in the George Sank, and he was the Prince de Galles next door. And he said, would you like to do The Man Who Would Be King? I said, yeah, I'll do anything with you, Huston, because I loved him. And I said, where are you? He said, I'm in the Prince de Galles in the bar next door. Come and have a drink.
Hey, mister, will you stick a fellow American to a meal?
Such impudence never came my way. Early this afternoon, I gave you money. While I was having my shoes polished, I gave you more money. Now you put the bite on me again. Do me a favor, will you? Go occasionally to somebody else. It's beginning to get tiresome.
Oh, excuse me, mister. I never knowed it was you. I never looked at your face. I just looked at your hands and the money you gave me.
Beg pardon, mister. I promise I'll never put the bite on you again.
This is the very last you get from me. Just to make sure you don't forget your promise, here's another peso.
Thanks, mister. Thanks.
But from now on, you have to make your way through life without my assistance.
John used to like a vodka or two. I became enamored of it for quite a long while. But I mean, I gave all that up. All I do now is I don't drink in the daytime, and I only drink wine, and I only drink it with food. Because I really don't like to be bummed.
Kind of bitter. In a thin glass.
John was the easiest director. I mean, you'd say to John, you never give me any directions. And he'd say, you're earning a great deal of money to do this, Michael. I think you can do it all on your own. You don't need me. And he'd say, oh, yes, John, okay. But when he did give you a direction, it was succinct. I was in a couple of days into The Man Who Would Be King. I was on a long speech, and he cut me right in the middle. And actors hate that, you know, because you've got to do it again. It's a bloody great long speech. And I said, well, I hadn't made any mistakes. And I said, what is it, John? He said, you can speak faster, Michael. He's an honest man. And there was the whole character in one line. And I've never trusted anyone who speaks slowly since. I wish a guy comes up to me and says, hello, Michael, and how are you? I go, crook, what's he want? And I remember John.
And you authorized the payoff, huh?
Yep.
And you're the top man.
That's right.
What about Brewster?
We know about Brewster.
Retard! The
two of us run things, Brewster and I.
Nobody else?
That's right.
Nobody?
There's a money man.
What's his name?
Fairfax.
One of my favorite films of all time, Point Blank. I loved Lee Marvin. It's another one of my favorite actors. But the difference between him, I never ever met Bogart, but I knew Lee very well. But I thought Point Blank was a knockout gangster movie. Really, that's the one I loved. That's why I wanted to do Get Carter. I wanted to try and do a movie like that. Well, I look for something different because I've been an actor for a very, very long while, for 52 years, actually. And I started in repertory theatre, which was 40 or 50 different plays a year, one every week. So I was used to playing different people, and that's how I saw being an actor. And so I've always been a sort of leading actor in a movie rather than a movie star based on one personality. You know, you get some movie stars who say, oh, we can't do that, Michael Caine wouldn't do that. You know, in my case, I would do anything. They'd change my hair, the face, whatever, voice, look. I change it. My definition of the difference between a movie star and a movie actor is a movie star gets a script and says, how can I change this to suit me? And a movie actor gets a script and says, how can I change me to suit it? That's the difference. You don't retire from the movies, they retire you. You know? The scripts stop coming or the money is too small to make it worthwhile getting up in the morning. You get up very early, you've got to learn all this dialogue, and it's always dark and cold when you go out, so you need some incentive. So if they won't pay you any money, you say to hell with it. My own view, the way I work, is I regard myself as retired, and I only come out of retirement for offers I can't refuse, like I haven't worked for a year, but I wanted to play Batman's butler. I wanted to play Nicole's dad in Bewitched. And there's another film which will just come out now called The Weatherman, and I played Nicolas Cage's dad in that. They were all three parts that fascinated me. Not big, which is what I wanted, because, you know, if you play the lead in the movie, you've got to go out and promote it like hell, and you're on the set every day. And I wasn't ready for another one of those leads after The Quiet American, which was a very tough row for me. That Q secured me of playing leads for a while. I had a very hard job even getting that shown, but I did. Then I've gone a year not having found anything I wanted to do. But now I will do something. Suddenly there's three pictures I want to do. None of them are big parts. There's one, Alfonso Cuarón, who did Y Su Mama También. He has a movie which is going to shoot the next movie, which I do. It's not a massive part, but it's I wanted to work with him, and I love it. It's a vignette. And then Christopher Nolan, who directed Batman, is doing a smaller film, and I will do that. That's called The Prestige. It's a thriller about magicians, murderous magicians. It's two young guys, and I'm the older guy who makes all their tricks for them. It's very interesting. So that dragged me out of retirement. And then, of course, I'm the butler in Batman, and we're going to make The Joker next year. So that definitely drags me out of retirement. So that's what I do. I've had a fabulous summer. I haven't done anything. I've done stuff. I'm very good at stuff. I do lots of stuff. Like, I write books, I do gardening, I do cooking, I build bits on my house. I'm always up to some stuff. And I learn all these modern machines, you know, like faxes and how to put your music in your iPod. And oh, God, it drives me nuts.
You can pass the button around when the car went over the top. Hey! Goodbye!
I think you should remake Failures. I remade two Failures. I remade a film that was a failure for Marlon Brando and David Niven. I forget what it was called now, but we called it Dirty Rotten Scoundrels. And then Michael Redgrave did a terrible version of The Quiet American, and we remade that. But I don't want to remake a successful picture, except Jude Law and I have got together, and we might remake Sleuth, because we've got a very good script from Harold Pinter. That might be worth doing, with me in, obviously in the older Olivier part and him playing my part. But we haven't got that set up yet.
You must remember this, a kiss is just a kiss, a sigh is just a sigh.
I think classic movies are terribly important, and it's great because the children see them on television. I remember I was in a car with somebody who knew Julia Roberts, and I'd never met Julia Roberts. And so, you know, when someone sort of gives you a phone and says, "Say hello to Julia," it was his friend, not mine. And he said, "Hi, Julia, I'm Michael Caine." I thought, "What do I say?" I loved you in Pretty Woman. I thought, what else can I say? And there was a long pause. And she said, "I can't believe I'm talking to Alfie." I said, "How the hell do you know Alfie?" I said, "I made Alfie literally before you were born." She said, "You ever heard of television, Michael?" And that's what it is. And they see these classics. And I have a list of the 100 greatest films of all time. And you know when you get someone who has everything, and that what do you buy them for a present? If they are film buffs, that's what I buy them. Because there's many of them they've never seen. My favorite films of all time are The Third Man, Casablanca, and On the Waterfront.
Do you mind if I ask you a few questions? Unofficially, of course.
Make it official, if you like.
What is your nationality?
I'm a drunkard.
And that makes Rick a citizen of the world.
That's my three. All in black and white, funnily enough. Best line, they always do lines from Casablanca. My favorite line from Casablanca, as we're in Paris, she says, "Do you remember Paris?" He says, "Yes, I do." He said, "The Germans wore gray and you wore blue."